comments. You're in the seat today. I'm picking up that you have never granted a personality profile interview.
Never.
I'm a lucky one.
Well, you lured me into this.
You had no say at all. Anyway, you read computer science.
Yes. For my first degree, yes, I did.
At KNUSD.
KNUSD.
Tell me about your days at KNUSD. I hear you were a radical.
What kind of student were you? I was still quiet, just as I am.
Quiet.
Without one plea.
Sometimes I'm not sure you are a quiet man.
No, I have always been like this. Uh-huh. If you can describe how I am today, it's
not quiet.
Well, I mean, I went to tech to read computer science, and it was such a positive, impactful time in my life where I created relationships that I still benefit from today. Being the experience that I had in tech at the time is the experience that I always tell myself that if I had the chance, the opportunity to choose again which school I should go, it will forever be KNUST, and specifically Queen Elizabeth II Hall.
What made it so special?
I mean, the kind of people that I met in tech, most of who are still very good friends, people that I work together in committees with, on event planning and things. You know, at the time, and I don't know about now, tech had a very active social setup, if you know what I mean, because a large percentage of the students were into what I call pseudo-professional courses. Mm. They knew exactly what they had come for, and so it made their social life very active, and most of them had traveled from outside of Kumasi, and so you didn't have this situation where every weekend people had to go back home. Mm. So the people looked up to the weekend for excitement. Mm. And the whole weeks were great, you know. And we celebrated our lives while we were there. I wasn't an activist, as you put it.
You were not?
I didn't cause
any problems at all?
No. It depends on where you stand. Mm. I don't see myself as having been a problem child in school. Mm. At tech, I'd rather say that one incident that drew some of us into the active segment of student politicking would be when 16 people were rusticated for something that we believe was not fair, and which brought out this activism in us. Myself, Yao Nsankun, who is now the CEO of Unilever Nigeria, Napo, who is in politics. Mm-hmm. At the time, Adainimo was the SRC president. Mm. One of my colleagues is a general manager of engineers and planners at the IETV. Very, very excellent speaker. Mm. I always tell him that it's unfortunate that he didn't go into politics. Another solid guy who was one of our colleagues is Kaminta Beisi, who is the chief executive of the State Enterprises Commission. I mean, it was like a community of friends,
right,
and we loved what we did on campus. And proudly, I was a member of ISEC.
What's ISEC?
It's the Association of Students in Economics and Management, you know, which was a very active organization, which also shaped some of us, and we picked up lessons from some of our friends in ISEC, through ISEC I also was networked to then the three universities, so Cape Vars and Legon, and so I made friends through ISEC, through, you know, very good friends who are still very good friends. Mm-hmm. Michael Coblan, who used to be Ecobank transnational boss, the current GNA boss, Bernard Otabil, and you know, scores of them.
Nice.
You know. So we had a fulfilling life on campus UST.
That's good. And then you went on to Leicester.
That was many years later.
What did you do after tech? Because I'm reading snippets from your CV. You worked with Coca-Cola. In Sierra Leone?
That's way later. Yeah, I mean, okay, so my background prior to tech, I went to Swedish Secondary School for my O-level, Form 1 up to Form 5, and I did my sixth form in Laboni Secondary School. Primary school was a different story because I had changed schools like 6 times before I wrote my common entrance. Nana, you know what common entrance is, right? Okay.
I heard about it.
Okay, so it's in your history book, right? Okay, so the entry to secondary school, you know. And so I had grown up with a mixed exposure to different cultures because I had moved from different parts of the country, except for the northern region. I've been to every one of the regions and experienced life there. Not for a hit and run visit, like go there in the morning. I'm talking about at some point in my life, I'd had to live in the Eastern region, I'd had to live in Ashanti region, some parts of the Brungahafa region, and most parts in the Greater Accra region. So it's, and I grew up with the memories. I never left any of them. And again, they were reinforced by the associations that I made in school. Because I meet somebody from the Brungahafa region, I know what language to speak to him because I have a background. Eastern region, I know what kind of Akan that I can speak with somebody from the Eastern region. I did some boarding school education in Achimoda, Hector International. I did some school in Greater Accra, New Hope School in Kolibu. And so it gives me a good mix of interactions.
Right. And Swesco?
Swesco was good.
Yeah?
Swesco was good.
How many years did you spend?
5 years.
5 years.
From one to form five. From 5 years. Swedu Secondary School. I must say that I never found my identity until I got to Form 3.
Do you go back there?
I do, not regularly. I have done that maybe few and far between when there's an occasion that requires the involvement of my year group. Then I go. And I don't take my year group for granted because they keep me in remembrance of where I started from. We have a chat group and which I'm very active on. And I deal with the people regardless of their social status because at some point in time, once upon a time, we're in the same class.
Absolutely.
And so it reminds me of who I am.
So how did you end up in the media? I mean, computer science background, you did an MBA.
How I ended up in the media was not by any design. It was I just strayed into the media. I as you said, my first degree was computer science. And trust me, I wasn't such an excellent student. So
you were not?
No, I was not. I had a second class lower, which really is not so much to write home about, let me say humbly. I'm not saying that is the worst thing that could ever happen to anybody, but it's easy for people to let this in that I was such an excellent student, and since I was not. I was just an average student who struggled through my education day by day, and I took it one day at a time. Having said that, I entered the university with a fervent hope that I was going to make it to first class, and then I drew down to second class upper. And then I got into the politics, and then that took more of my time. And then I had to weigh between the world out there, what does it require, you know? So where do I invest my time? I ended up with a lower, which I am grateful for. I did not fail, so I passed through. But when I came out, there was a friend that I made while we were in Queen's Hall. Queen's Hall, we were like family.
Okay.
You know, we lived like family. And one of my closest pals in Queen's Hall is Carlos Kingsley Ahinkra.
You must be very happy for him now.
who is now the new Patriotic Party candidate for Tema West. You know, very great guy. Very, very good guy. You know, and I remember when we were in school, he used to give us money when we were broke.
I see. Interesting.
Because Carlos was, he was just, say, a year older than most of us. But he understood business.
Right.
And this guy was in school in Kumasi, and he was running his business in Tema Harbor.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yes. at age 23, 22, he used to travel weekends to go and see his people and come back. He had his car parked. Then, you know, students owning cars on campus wasn't popular, you know. And so to answer your question, how I entered, I made a friend on campus UST by the name of Daniel Chum. He's passed on now. Now, Danny is the one that introduced me to the media, because whilst I was in school, I happened to be emceeing almost every event, and I was very active in the Scripture Union, which we call Interhall Christian Fellowship. So the mystery about me, as witnessed by most people on campus, would say that they used to call some of us Krife ninjas.
Yes.
Krife ninja. So this guy, in one breath, he's hosting a social program, in another breath, he's hosting a religious program. So what kind of person?
I said, well, I
just want to live my life, man. I live with human beings, not angels.
Yeah.
So I need to be relevant to all persons at all times. So I would MC hall programs or MC faculty programs. And I used to lace my delivery with a lot of comedy. I used to even stage comedy at a great hall. You know, things like that. So I remember our last hall dinner before we left Queen's Hall. The hall tutor, after my performance, held me aside and said that you should consider working at GBC when you finish this course. And I was like, GBC? GB? What? No way! You know, it never crossed my mind that radio would be an option. Never, ever. But 2 or 3 years or so after school, Danny called me and said the brother was setting up a radio station and that he thinks I can help. And I said, well, I don't know anything about radio, and how can I help? So, no, ideas, let's put, you know, so and so and so, what we used to do in school. I said, no, I can't do that. Mm-hmm. You know, so my condition for joining was that if you allow me to do a gospel program in addition to whatever I do, that is how I got myself. So they said, well...
So it was Kwesi Chum you were introduced to?
Yes, okay. Who happens to be Kwesi Chum.
Okay.
So it's Daniel Chum, Junior Chum, we all call him, who introduced me to Kwesi Chum. And I sat with Kwesi Chum and then the late Brigadier Chum, and then they told me about the whole vision and everything. And so I initially started, whilst I was still doing my computer stuff, you know, working in between the two. But after a year or so, they urged me to take it on a full-time basis. So my first official, you know, formal engagement with media was when I became programs manager, I think in 96 or so, after Tommy Anforsen left multimedia. So that's how I got into it.
The media.
Yes, and I met Kwesi Chum, who showed us the way to do things. He himself didn't have a prior experience in radio. Everything he knew in radio would be what he experienced as a listener, a consumer, and what he read, maybe his few interactions with people in the U.S. What people didn't know is that Kwesi himself used to sell rice and sugar in Mokola before he set up this as a business. He's an econs graduate. I mean, he's done further studies after that, but he was a graduate from, no, don't get me wrong, he knew his mathematics, he knew his economics, but he knew how to make money as well. So he exposed us to all these rudiments of media management at that age. I was, I think, 27, 28.
So how does he feel about you managing a radio station now and giving him so much competition?
Well,
you're still in touch, aren't you?
I am still in touch, but you know, if you know Kwesi Chum, most of you bear me out, he doesn't use a mobile phone. So it's very difficult to reach out to him.
To him, yeah.
You know, and at times it occurs to me, you haven't spoken to Kwesi in a long time, and then I ask myself, but how do I reach him? You know, that kind of thing.
Mm.
But every now and then he calls me. Mm. Every now and then he calls me. You know, when there are issues that require our contribution, he will call. I mean, unofficially, he stays back, but influences from yonder, you know.
Mm-hmm.
He will have an influence on you without being in your face, you know, because he never forces you to do anything, but he can influence. And that's the kind of...
Why did you leave Joy FM?
I had to go and do my master's.
Oh, that's when you left for
Yes,
Leicester.
So I've been at Joy for 5 years. And after I was involved in setting up Love FM in Kumasi. And then the last project was setting up Adom FM in Tema at the time. So at the time when I was going, I was running programming in Joy, in Adom, and in Love FM in Kumasi. So I used to do, then we had an aircraft airline called Milk Air or something like that. We used to fly to Kumasi. Thursdays, Friday, I come back to Accra, and I lived on the Sprinters Road. So
then you drive to Tema.
You know, so it was a round robin kind of game that.
And for somebody who never planned to do media, look at you now.
I'm a survivor.
You're a survivor.
I am a survivor.
You're a hustler.
Well, a survivor. Let me put it that way.
We'll go for that one. Anyway, some of your staff say that you operate what they call a linear style of leadership. Where a security man can just walk into your office and give you information or discuss something of relevance with you, the same way a radio presenter can walk in, anybody at all would have access to you. And they say you are serious, I think they're confused. You're serious and at the same time very friendly. You will still be at work getting your results, but in a very friendly manner.
I was hoping it wouldn't come to that, because I don't know what... this will come to from somebody who probably understood the way I worked. There are people.
Is there a reason you choose that style?
I think it's just a reflection of my personality and my experiences growing up. I have known how to abase, and I have known how to abound. I have worked as a security man before whilst I was doing my master's program, and so I have the empathy of a security person. When I go into a restaurant, I look out for the waiters and the waitresses. There are times that if I have, say, you know how you give them the tip, I kind of engage them. Why are you doing this job at this time? And they say, oh, we are putting money together to go to school. And I prefer that. So what kind of money? So and so. At times, I follow up. It's just who I am. I don't struggle to do that. I do not struggle to do that. And I don't pretend to be doing that for the cameras, because it's who I am. At times, I wake up and I walk straight to Jamestown. And I stand at the beach and I remember my childhood. At times, I wake up, I take my children, we drive to the village in the eastern region, Pramkesi, Achimtechima, Akropong, Kedebwedria, all these places, just for them to know where I have come from. So it's just who I am. As for the leadership style, I don't know. The people who have worked with me who can tell me. There are people who cannot stand the way I do things, because I tend to every now and then be a little bit pushy to get things done. And those that cannot get things done normally don't become my friends. I mean, again, you don't have to become my friend to work with me.
Absolutely.
You don't have to. And there are people who in the past have struggled with their personalities, but because they deliver, you let them, go on with their lives. So we've had good times and challenging times in leadership.
Okay, and I dare say that your station at the moment, I think, is running the best morning show in Ghana.
We thank God for that, and the difficulty is how to sustain such a thing, and I'm sure you know that more than I do. Going up to the mountaintop is not the most difficult one.
It's staying how to stay there is always a problem.
The advertising power keeps decreasing. We haven't had active advertisement from the breweries like we used to do. The soft drink companies are not advertising like they used to do. The telcos are not advertising like they used to do. And so we are left with a smaller portion of the advertising value to be shared among all the media outlets. So it's a challenging space for us. It's a very competitive space. And there are times that I sit behind the audience measurement tools, and on daily basis, I study the patterns and I find out reasons why we go up at times, why we come down at times. And you know, for what I'm exposed to, I use a geopole to do the measurement. Geopole is an audience measurement tool. And I see the sinusoidal relationship between Adum FM and Peace FM, for instance. Mm-hmm. Peace is up today, Adum is down. Adum is up today, Peace is down. That kind of curve. I see the sinusoidal relationship between CitiFM and Joy FM. Joy is up today, City is down. You know, that kind of situation. So every day presents us with an opportunity to do what I call the magic. You know, how can you be more relevant than your competitor? Do you have the resources, comparative advantage? Can you compete? Competitive advantage, can you compete? And these are the things that engage me on daily basis. And I'm not your regular managing director. Mm. I am definitely not.
Okay. Let's move away from CitiFM. Well, it's somehow connected to CitiFM. And you, as a media man, you've been picked up by the BNN how many times? You seem to know the walls too well. The walls are in love with you.
I have been invited by the Bureau of National Investigation.
Okay, you were not picked up. You were invited.
Well, picked up the first time.
The first time with a Rollins tape.
Yes.
You were picked up.
Picked up. That was scary, man. That was scary.
Yeah?
Yes, that was scary. And that was in 99 when I was programs manager at Joy FM. One Saturday morning, you know, there was talk about a tape that was suggesting that the then president was involved in something close to murder, you know. And it was a tape, it was an issue that we had discussed the Friday before. And my advice at the time as programs manager was that I wasn't sure it was a credible piece until we have reason to believe. So they should put a hold on that. And then Saturday, I was away, I think, up the mountains in Ebury when I had a call that they played it on Newsfile. Mm-hmm. You know, at that time, Newsfile was relatively a new program that we had put together. And so I was a bit alarmed when I heard that it had been played. And I think it was then Akosi Alabi was one of the producers. So she called and told me. So I quickly called the studio that they should discontinue. By which time, I was a bit late. I think the program had even ended. Morning after, I had a call from the Nima police station. The commander there was one Yakubu. I remember his name, a light-skinned man from, you know, from the north. And so he called me and said, well, they were under instruction to pick us for interrogation regarding the tape. I said, well, that's fine. So programs manager, they bypassed the news editor and all those people, and then they came for me. And so I was home morning. I think I had just finished presenting my program, Then the Reason is Jesus. And then I joined them. So I sat in there, you know, that thing. And then we went to the police headquarters. So when I got there, I found Ferdinand Eyim, you know, of blessed memory, Kweku Bakun, Gehat Atta Mensah. He was then the editor of the Evening News, I think. Yeah. And then a few others. And they kept us there like forever, you know. So deep into the night. So until the following day when they arranged us before their BNI bosses to interrogate us individually. But when they picked me up from the police headquarters, they separated all of us. Mm. Yeah, and then they took some to some police outlet somewhere. But they took me to the BNI office.
Around Alliance Francaise.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, the one on the 37th area. And it was this huge... it felt like a warehouse, and you are left to sit inside alone, you know. So I was there, and I was alone, and you know what I was doing?
No.
I was doing the... you know, you do it, and you hear
yourself, echoes.
And that tells you that you are alone. You know, I was left there for hours, and then I was there. Somebody came, said, come along. They took us back. I went to face a Sanhedrin of... BNI people led by the then Mr. Anokumi. I think he was a deputy BNI boss or something like that. Well, they questioned us about the tape, and I said, you know, some of the police people were not nice, I must say. Some were slapping people and all that, you know.
But you were not slapped?
No, I was not. I was not. I did not provoke them.
All right.
But you know, they were very nasty to some of the people, I must say. Now, the second episode would
which
be...
Which is quite recent.
Quite recent. Nayeli. Which received media attention would be a few months ago, late last year, right?
Yeah,
when the lady, what's her name, Ruby's cocaine thing came up and our website published it. And then I was again invited and it made the headlines. So, you know, for the kind of work that I do and the kind of exposures that we are made to go through, for which reason I get invited every now and then. But not because I'm such a notorious character.
Okay.
Who cannot stay away from the BNI.
Yeah, but these guys who were slapped by the BNI or the police, were they journalists as well?
Yeah, of course.
Kweku Bako was slapped?
No way.
he wouldn't dare provoke
no,
them.
No, I mean, Kweku Bako has not changed.
Okay, he's always been like that.
Yeah, I mean...
So which of them was slapped then?
No, I will not mention.
All right, we'll move on. Let's move on. Recently, you had a big problem with Craig Murray. He's always posting something or the other. I think he's obsessed with Africa. He's obsessed with Ghana. And you are not too comfortable with some of the issues he raised. That Joy FM was almost closed down at some point during the 2000 elections.
I think where I agreed with Craig Murray, who really at the time was a deputy high commissioner. I agreed with him until up to the point where he said that he was working with me to unsettle the then President Rawlings or something funny like that, and how he used to come to my office for us to share a bottle of whiskey, and I almost threw up when I heard that one because I don't even know what whiskey looks like. So when the man talks about a bottle of whiskey and all that, we used to work together on media development, and I had been involved in most of the projects that we had done with the UK High Commission, with American Embassy, at the time US Information Service under the leadership of Mr. Bruce Lohov. The UK High Commission were working with Mike Nitavranakis, and we had a close relationship. It wasn't defined as anti-government, or it was a media empowerment, you know, because we had come out of this media monopoly, and the opportunities were there to empower the media. So he will pay visits to our office every now and then. Now, what he referred to in his book would be something that happened the night before the elections, when he was doing, according to him, his rounds and came to Joy FM. And then while he was there, a group came that they had been detailed by the national security to come and shut down the station. I think this is the point that he made, that they had been asked to come and shut
down. And that was a lie?
It was a lie.
Okay.
It was a lie. So, at the time, my good friend Paul Adumochi, then a young journalist, was there. I think we used to do decision. So, it was decision 2000. So, while he was there, the program decision was going on in the studio. And we were having a chat at the studio, the front desk. So, these guys came in. There were about four of them that came that they had been detailed to. So, I said to them that nobody shuts a station from the studio.
Yeah.
If you want to shut it, you go to the transmitter site. If you are national security, that's one. And so Paul Admotri said, okay, wait. So he picked up his phone. And then, you know, Uncle Tudobi, there are some people here who said, within seconds, the people vanished. And it turns out that Paul wasn't even talking to Tudobi.
Make believe.
Yeah, so it was one of those gimmicks that, you know, party people would put up every now and then. Yeah.
Okay. Now, you seem not to be a friend of the NDC. You said it countless times that...
I have not said that I'm not a friend of the NDC.
You said you don't like them.
I know. I said I'm a supporter of the New Patriotic Party.
But...
There's no buts.
But, okay. I've heard you say that. As for NDC.
No. Okay. I have said. No, and I'm telling you what I have said. That I'm a supporter of the NPP.
Okay.
I have never said that I don't like the NDC.
Okay.
I have friends in the NDC.
Mm-hmm.
The president, John Mahama, is my friend.
Mm.
And I'm proud of him.
Mm.
But I don't support his party. That's, that's you know,
we
should get to that point where we can... We can be frank about these things. And by that saying, I'm not saying that I'm an advocate of the New Patriotic Party. I am not.
Mm.
If they do something which is bad, and you know that,
yes,
I will let it be known to the whole world that it's bad. And that is what we should do.
Mm.
I am not saying that I will spend 20 years in the media and not have a choice
in which philosophy
I will support. I have brilliant friends in the NDC. Sylvester Mensah, it's like a twin brother.
Mm.
You understand? Kojo Bonsu is a senior brother to me. The president himself, I can name Antifosti Nelson. Or you know, I'm sure scores of them.
Right.
I respect them and I love them for what they do. But when it comes to the choice for political persuasion,
you would vote for
I belong to a different philosophy. That's all I'm saying.
All right. I understand at some point you were almost beaten up for cancelling some Beanie Man concert.
Oh, man.
How do you cancel Beanie Man's concert?
Well, I think it's the Beanie Man concert would be the lowest point in my career.
Yeah.
The lowest point in my career as a media practitioner. You know, what Kwesi Tchoum had taught us was that we should move away from just engaging in broadcasting, you know, broadcasting, now move into engaging the audiences.
Right.
And how you engage the audiences would be through interacting with them physically.
Right. Mm.
And so you do your outside broadcast projects, you do events, you do promotions and stuff like that. So when I started CitiFm, one of our hallmarks was to engage our audiences through events, entertainment events, business events and the like. So we asked ourselves, what single event can we do to bring us from the oblivion situation to the limelight? And so we made the choice of bringing Beanie Man, who at the time was, you know, top of the ratings. And so we chose to do the Beanie Man concert. Beanie Man came to Accra, we had 2 days of Beanie Man, one at the conference center and one at the stadium. We did the first night, it was a Friday night, I think. We did it successfully. And then the following day, or the Saturday, I was supposed to do a stadium one. And around 6:30 p.m., when people had started massing up at the stadium, we had to cancel it. And it wasn't a pleasant experience.
It was, you were almost lynched.
I mean, people were backing at me. And, you know, initially, I wanted to leave the scene. But I just told my staff that everybody leave, let me remain at the stadium gate. And so people were insulting, people were doing all sorts of things. But I just took it.
But as a Jamestown boy, you could deal with it.
Well, these are not the kind of things I want to
do.
Because you don't know them. You know, you don't know who is doing what. So it was a bit difficult to manage.
Okay.
But it was a difficult.
All right. I have just a minute to go. 3 questions. Are you a womanizer?
It doesn't happen to me.
It doesn't?
No. You've been my friend like forever.
That's true. Maybe I'm not your type.
Well, God knows who is my type.
But people seem to think that you're
But people think all sorts of things about you.
That's true.
Does it make it you?
No.
Well,
that's what I'm asking you.
If you live your life in the limelight, people say all sorts of things.
So nothing at all.
You should tell me. But I know you and I know your house where you used to live and all that. So
I know.
You have the answer. I'm a Christian.
You're a Christian, so
yes.
Just the wife.
It doesn't work with our Christian focus.
Okay. The reason is Jesus.
Say that again.
Yeah, the reason is Jesus. Okay, and your favorite meal?
Meal?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't have a favorite one.
You could do anything. Kinky.
Yeah, I mean, I don't
What's your favorite presenter at CitiFM?
I don't have one.
You don't? Even my schoolmate, Jessica.
I don't have one.
Oh, because I thought you were going to say Jessica.
I work with every one of them. Yeah. I work with Jessica. I work with Bernard, Sky, every one of them.
Okay. Yeah. Your favorite color?
Oh, those are for women.
Yeah, you don't have. And sadly, you're an Arsenal fan.
Well, I believe in Arsenal as a football club.
And which team do you support in Ghana?
I'm a Hearts of Oak fan.
Oh, dear.
I'm a Hearts of Oak fan.
How do you support Hearten?
Well, I'm a Hearts of Oak fan. I support Arsenal, and I love Arsenal, and the Community Shield is coming up. Sadly, Manchester United is not featuring. Is that team most important?
We've won it how many times? I mean, Community Shield is not important.
When Arsenal talks about history, they say we should disregard it. We are talking about them now. And so on Sunday, the two most important clubs will feature at the Wembley Stadium. See you
and
there.
You're winning that one?
Yes, please.
You are?
Yes, please.
I'll be happy to see you win.
I'll send you pictures.
You'll be there?
Yes, please.
Oh, that's nice. Interesting. Komla Dumor, I mean, sports is next. Very close friend of yours, wasn't he?
Yeah.
How did you take his
Well, I mean, it was something that, you know, anytime I've been asked about Komla, I really ran out of words because it still feels like he's not dead. He was so active in our lives that it's taking us a bit too long to let go of that experience with Komla. Komla was a proper human being. I mean, you know, he had his convictions about life, and he pursued them regardless of, you know, the general hiccups that you get. He will go for what he believes in. And yes, I was his boss at some point, but I used to learn a lot from him. His ways of doing things, his approach to networking with people, getting to know people, and all that. So, I think it's a whole book about Komla. If you give me another hour,
you go.
But we do miss Komla. I do miss Komla.
Yeah.
You know, as I said before, I had started writing a book together with Komla. I mean, with his help. Because he will prompt me every now and then on some of the experiences. So there are times that, you know, 11 p.m. he will be on his way home from work in London. And he comes and says, Charlie, you remember this experience where we went to so and so, and I have to put it down, you know. And trust me, from the day Komla departed till now, I have not added a word to the book.
Very sad.
So I'm struggling to put myself together to kind of complete this book that we've been trying to.
Thank you very much, Samuel Atta Mensah, for your time this morning.
Thank you.
So many things I didn't know about you, despite how long I've known you.
No, you are a bad girl.
Thank you so much.